I love my home server. It's very convenient, allows me to self-host an incredible variety of services, share my files across devices, and connect to my home network from anywhere. On the other hand though, my lovely home server is just that, a home server. It sits in my house, and if I need to move, I have to set it up all over again for new IP addresses. If you've ever wished your home server wasn't so set in stone, or if you're just curious to see what we'll do today, listen up. What if I told you you can make a personal server that's physically tiny, dead simple to use, accessible from anywhere in the world, and network agnostic so that you can move it without any hassle? It might sound too good to be true, but it is possible, and I'm going to show you how to do it. I'm Chris Carlos, I like computers, and this is the Portable Personal Server. The concept that we're going for is as follows. A Linux server running Tailscale, on which you can host literally anything, and access it from anywhere. The smaller the hardware, the better, but you can do this with any old hunk of junk, like an old laptop, any single board computer, like a Raspberry Pi, or even a whole server rack if you love cosplaying Sisyphus and carrying it around everywhere you go. For this video, we're going to be using this little thing, the ZimaBoard 832. It's a portable single board x86 computer kindly sent to me by IceWhale Tech, the company that created it, for free. However, IceWhale Tech have not sponsored this video, and all opinions on the hardware and software are my own. While it's meant to be used as more of a networking gadget with its 2 gigabit Ethernet ports, I'm going to use it as the lab rat of today's video because I never play by the rules. It boasts a quad-core Intel Celeron N3450 processor, 8 GB of RAM, and 32 GB of eMMC 5.1 storage. We won't be needing more storage than that for this project, but if we wanted to make it a proper NAS, we could expand the storage using the 2 SATA ports and 3D printing a dock for it with hard drive mounts. The interesting thing about it is that it comes pre-installed with CasaOS, an easy-to-use and open-source web interface for home servers running on top of Debian. This makes it a perfect candidate for this project because it means we can install any Docker-contained application with one click through CasaOS, so this should be a piece of cake, no lie. You can install CasaOS on pretty much any Linux server, by the way, so you don't have to feel left out. Don't let the FOMO get you. Oh, but extremely important warning. If you followed our $0 home server guide, do not install CasaOS on your server, at least not without backing up your Samba configuration file first. CasaOS will overwrite your Samba settings and does not officially support modifying the configuration file after the fact. If you're feeling brave, you can give it a shot, but you won't need CasaOS to achieve the setup we're creating in this video. Everything we'll do through CasaOS can also be achieved very easily through the terminal. All we have to do to get the ZimaBoard up and running is plug it into a router via Ethernet, give it power, and it's ready. It automatically assigns itself the internal URL of casaos.local, and we can just open up a browser and go to it for setup. After creating our user, we're greeted with the CasaOS interface, which is actually really simple. We can install apps through the App Store, view the stats of our machine, restart it or shut it down, and if we need to get into more advanced tasks, we can also SSH into it and issue terminal commands. Now we should have the ability to access the server from anywhere, regardless of what network it's plugged into. Unfortunately, right now, we don't have that ability. That's where Tailscale comes in. If you've watched our $0 home server video, you'll know we covered Wireguard with PyVPN for creating a VPN to your home network. The problem with self-hosted WireGuard, as many, and I mean many, truly an overwhelming amount of viewers pointed out, is that it requires a network that is not behind CGNAT. Also, WireGuard is really not beginner-friendly or easy to use, because you have to mess with your router settings and forward ports to get it to work, which many people find confusing. To make matters worse, WireGuard is very difficult to troubleshoot on the rare occasion that something goes wrong with it. All of these issues are solved by Tailscale, which we will be installing first. It's easy to use and beginner friendly, just like the sponsor of this video, Brilliant. If you want to start learning about a topic like AI or programming from scratch in a fun way that makes you forget you're even studying, Brilliant is the place to go. It's a uniquely effective way to learn about complex topics such as math, data analysis, programming, AI, and more. You can start as a complete beginner and level up by learning a little bit every day at your own pace. Brilliant's rewarding system encourages you to develop a learning habit, helping you keep your brain sharp while also having fun. It's portable too, just like the home server we're setting up in this video, so you can take it with you on your phone if you want to pass some time on the train, or you can try hard a course in your RGB-enabled gaming chair at home. No matter where you use Brilliant, It helps you develop real-world problem-solving skills instead of just memorizing answers to questions, making sure you're building actual knowledge on the topics you're studying. I really like Brilliant, and I think you'll really like it too. To try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days, visit brilliant.org/kalos or scan the QR code on the screen. After the trial, you'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. Back to Tailscale. It uses Wireguard in the background, but it's fundamentally different from most self-hosted VPNs in the sense that it doesn't create a tunnel from one network to another, but rather connects devices to each other across any network. At least by default. There is a way to make any device an exit node, but we won't be covering that functionality in this video. So, for example, we won't be able to access the router the server is connected to, but we will be able to access CasaOS and any apps that we install through it. No port forwarding or router setting shenanigans required. The shenanigans that are required, though, have to do with installing Tailscale in CasaOS, as it's not in the App Store. For those of you at home not using CasaOS, this should be easy as pie, no Raspberry, because installing Tailscale through the terminal is as simple as running a single command. In CasaOS, we have to install it as a custom application and tweak some settings, and all the steps we need to do this are outlined in the guide we used, which is linked in the description. The gist of it is, set up a Tailscale account, create a reusable access token, set your access token as a parameter in the Docker container, and make sure to name the Docker container anything you want, as this will be a part of the URL you'll be using to access the server. If you missed that step like I did at first though, don't worry. You can change the name and thus the link of the device through Tailscale later. Next, we install Tailscale on the devices we want to access the server from and log in with the account we created. Something you should know that's not mentioned in the guide is that in order for the server to not go offline when the authentication key we created expires, we need to open the Tailscale interface in a browser, go to machines, and disable key expiry for our server. Also, as previously mentioned, the token should be reusable so that the server can seamlessly reconnect to Tailscale regardless of what network it's plugged into. If anything breaks or your authentication token expires, you can just replace the parameter in the Docker container with a new authentication token and it should work just fine. Now, with Tailscale on, we can access the server from the URL it's been assigned, which we can find by clicking on the device in the app or web UI. From here on out, you can host anything you want on the server. The guide part of the video is pretty much done, and now we'd like to show off a utility that we think you'll find cool. Immich, meant to sound like image, is a self-hosted, free and open source alternative to cloud storage solutions for saving and organizing your photos. A certain company with a colorful logo seems to have a bit of a monopoly in this space currently, and I know a lot of you, including myself, are paying to host your photos there, as it seems like it's the only option. Well, it doesn't have to be this way. Immich has a very comparable interface and is in very active development, so it's constantly improving. In my opinion, it's at the point right now where it's feature competitive with the other service that shall not be named, and that's really impressive because it's been in development for only a couple of years. Installing Immich under CasaOS is as easy as going into the App Store, searching for Immich, and clicking install. It'll automatically create a Docker container, install the application, open up the port, and start it up for you. Now that we've installed Immich, launching it for the first time lands us in the setup page. It's very important to note that since Immich can still be unstable at times, it recommends that you keep backups of your files instead of trusting it fully to keep your photos safe. Kind of annoying in my opinion, as the team seems to be avoiding all responsibility for pushing out potentially buggy code, but I understand it to some extent. At the same time, when you're making a utility for organizing files, I think it is your duty to make sure those files don't get lost because of a bad software update. But I digress, and I'm willing to cut a lot of slack because this is free and open source software that relies on donations to stay afloat. I like to go through the setup process keeping everything default, but it's up to you which settings you want to enable or disable. I can't tell you what to do, I'm not your dad, but your dad would probably want you to subscribe. Wait, I've already said that line in another video, what is the scriptwriter thinking? After we've set it up, that's it. We can just start uploading images and videos to it now, and Immich will categorize them by date, just like a certain other software does. In fact, it looks eerily similar to that software, and works the same way too, even on mobile. Oh yeah, there's a mobile version too. When setting up the mobile app, we made sure to have Tailscale on and pointed the app to the Tailscale address of our server so that it can work from anywhere. The mobile app looks even more familiar, and all the features we would expect from an app like this are here. Map view is great and works just as expected, allowing you to revisit your memories not only chronologically but also spatially. And Immich even has a face recognition machine learning algorithm built into it to categorize photos and videos based on the people in them. And don't worry, this AI runs entirely locally and does not send any data to any other server. But that's not even the most impressive part to me, honestly. The thing that impressed me the most is that Immich re-encodes the videos you upload to serve them to you faster, still keeping the original file available for download if you want it. It's so seamless that we didn't even notice it at first, until we figured out that the reason the CPU is pinned at 100% was the re-encoding process. The only feature that's missing, and sadly this is a great omission, is a free up space button that deletes all the media you've already backed up from your phone's storage. There is a long-standing GitHub issue about it though, so it might be implemented as a feature at some point. Overall, despite the warnings, I would use Immich to organize my photos and videos in a personal server. But the advice the developers give is really good advice, regardless of how much trust you'd like to put in the software. You should always be keeping backups of your important files, and while we won't be covering backup solutions in this video, we would love to cover it in the future, so you might want to hit the bell and enable notifications so that you don't miss it. Of course, Immich is just scratching the surface. We could self-host pretty much anything on here, like Home Assistant, dedicated game servers, a media server, a website, you name it. And that's the portable personal server. Thanks for watching! I hope you learned something new with this video, or at the very least had fun while watching it. Feel free to join our Discord server to talk about this project, or ask for help with any issues you might encounter. We'll do our best to help. I'm Chris Kalos, I like computers, and I'll see you next time.